Everyone, today I am taking you to Central California to a place called Folsom, California. If Folsom sounds familiar, you might be a Johnny Cash fan. Lots of people have heard Johnny Cash's album Live from Folsom Prison, which is kind of relevant because the building I want to talk to you was built by prisoners at Folsom Prison. Today we are talking about the Folsom Powerhouse. Today the Folsom Powerhouse probably sounds quite quaint, but this state park has a lot of historical relevance. Before we go to the power plant, I need to take you back to the year 1800. Back then, the world was literally a dark place. Pretty much the day started when the sun rose and finished when the sun set. But in the year 1800, something very interesting happened. Direct current was first discovered. Not much was understood at the time, but some scientists discovered that if they moved magnets a certain way, like a magical force, things would get pushed forward. This force would eventually be what was called today electricity. It was about this time a guy named Humphrey Davy invented what was called the arc light. Basically, he took two carbon rods, slightly distanced them, and when he pushed direct current between the two rods, a light appeared. The more electricity, the more light you got. This was very interesting in the development of electricity, but there were some problems. First of all, the carbon rods ran out constantly and had to be replaced. But the real problem was direct current only got you so far. The first commercial power plant was built in the year 1880 in New York, but most direct current power plants could only get electricity to travel for about 3 miles. To solve this issue, Nikola Tesla, who was originally an employee of Thomas Edison, invented alternating current, also known as AC. AC current was much more deadly to humans due to the higher voltages, but the big advantage to AC current was that it was able to travel long distances. To prove it, the Folsom Powerhouse was built.
This is super interesting. So on the end of the timeline there, 1895 is when this powerhouse got built. But if you back up in time, back before 1895 to 1887, 8 years earlier, the first DC hydroelectric powerhouse was constructed in California, the High Grove Station in San Bernardino, California. So where we live, and I was thinking, I did look it up, it burned down in 1915. So the building's not there anymore, but I bet you we could figure out where it was. And then 1890, still 5 years before, there's a single phase AC hydro, single phase instead of three phase. They built up in Oregon, but Willamette Falls Station, Oregon City, but that's gotta be near Salem there because it's the Willamette Falls Station. So down where we are, up where we have family in Salem, and then here in the middle, they do the three phase generator. Yeah, the three phase generator.
The Folsom Powerhouse was important to the discovery of electricity in that it was able to supply power 23 miles away to the state capital of Sacramento. The design for the Folsom Powerhouse was very simple, but it was also very genius. The Folsom Powerhouse was fueled by the American River. A canal was built that would supply water to a big pool called a forebay. The forebay had four big doors that pulled water by gravity down four metal tubes called penstocks that had a height of about 40 feet. These metal chutes are massive, and to give you an idea of how much water they could fill an Olympic-sized swimming pool in just 88 seconds. At the bottom of the penstocks were metal turbines that would spin a shaft that would spin the generators.
Or worse, that is not me. Oh, yeah. So this is what the forebay looks like today, empty, right? That's the old 1916 concrete bridge. It used to carry traffic down Riley Street onto this bridge and over the Rainbow Bridge up here before they put the bypass in Greenback Lane out here in 1963. Today, this is what it looked like when the plant was still in operation. So there's the water at the end of that 2 mile canal right before it pivots and ends up into the forebay here. You can see the water on either side of the wall that runs down the middle. That wall here and here was an engineering feature. What it did was allow them to operate and maintain the plant as if it were two separate power plants under the same roof, right? That was important because you can imagine as the water, we pull the water out of the river at the dam site, shoot it down a 2 mile canal, and it picks up debris. little rocks, silt, twigs, all the sorts of things that you don't want to let into the powerhouse at these turbines, right? At that velocity, a little pebble in the water would have just exploded one of those turbines. So what the power, or what the forebay did, was give the chance of water to settle down, lose its turbulence, and then all the particulate matter in the water would settle to the bottom. So when they opened the penstock gates higher up, the water that they let into the powerhouse was clean water, right? So it's basically a big water filtration plant. The wall down the middle gave them the ability to keep the forebay clean, right? You can imagine it picks up debris.
There was four generators inside the powerhouse that were also known as AC360 generators. If that sounds familiar to you, it's because that is the same standard that is used today for generating electricity in most modern standard homes. To keep the power steady, another machine was used that was called a regulator. This machine had the job of making sure the generators would spin consistently to the same RPMs. The RPMs is what regulated the amount of current going through the system. The equipment used in this powerhouse was massive, but it was amazingly durable. Despite many new technologies that were invented at the powerhouse, working at this facility was very dangerous. Just turning on the line was an adventure. The control panel for the operation is made of a special granite onyx mix mined in Tennessee. The stone has special properties in that it reduces sparks. The handles were metal covered in ceramic, but the people did not touch them with their bare hand. The switches were pushed with sticks, but even then, dangerous arcs were always a concern. Ever heard of the term the real McCoy? The real McCoy was actually a real person. His name was Bill McCoy, who in 1800 was a moonshiner. Being a moonshiner was a dangerous job, in that sometimes your equipment, especially if it wasn't lubricated, would blow up. This was an extremely dangerous job, so Mr. McCoy invented an oil drop cup that would use the motion of the engine to automatically distribute the oil to the machine and lessen the danger of the machine blowing up. His invention would be known as the McCoy drop cup. And this method of lubrication is like having the real McCoy. The speed of the turbines were fast, spinning at over 300 miles an hour. A little bit of metal that would fly off was basically faster than a bullet. If you look up into the ceiling, you can still see some dents of when the metal did fly. Many people were injured in this facility. The powerhouse was kind of unintentionally eco-friendly. All the water that came from the American River flowed right back into the river after it was used. And it was actually cleaner than when it first came into the forebay pools when it left the station. One thing that I found interesting in the powerhouse was the closed-circuit telephone system. It was basically one of the first telephone systems ever made and was used for different substations to talk to each other. There are seven lights on the top of the cabinet, and they would let you know which station was calling. The switches inside the cabin would connect you to the other stations. In 1952, the Folsom Powerhouse was closed when the Folsom Dam was completed. At that time, there was not enough water to continue operating the powerhouse. The powerhouse was then donated to the state of California, where it now remains as a state historic park. The Folsom Powerhouse is a very interesting place to visit and to learn how things work. The technology is old, but the basic principles of electricity and our current standards of electricity are still the same. You still need moving magnets, and alternating current still moves the world. Entrance to the museum is free, but there is a $10 parking fee. I hope you enjoyed the visit, and we will see you next time on the Pedroza Venture Channel.